You're listening to
The Bart Factor
with your host, Bart Robling.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to this episode of The Bart Factor. I'm your host, Bart Robley, and today, before I get started, I want to give a quick plug to my two sponsors for The Bart Factor, and that is drummerswag.com. Got a lot of fun, cool drummer t-shirts on there and educational material. And my other sponsor, which is Aquarian Drumheads. I've been with Aquarian for over 20 years, and they are fantastic. If you guys didn't see or hear, see, it's on YouTube. If you didn't hear my podcast, my interview with Chris Brady from Aquarian Drumheads, you can check that out. Really good interview. He gives some great insight on artist relations and getting endorsements and stuff like that. So one of the things I wanted to do with this podcast was interview people like that, people like Chris Brady and people in the business. And I also wanted to give my opinions on drumming and the music business and things that I feel sometimes are overlooked. And I also wanted to, you know, talk and interview some of my friends who are drummers and great players and, you know, and spread the word about them and interview them. And so that's exactly what I'm doing today. I'm sitting in the studio here at my house in the Bart Cave with my good friend, Dave Good. Hello, Dave. How are you?
Hey, how you doing? Thanks for having me.
Oh, man, it's my pleasure. Thank you for coming over. I really appreciate it. So before we get started and I start interviewing Dave, I'm going to tell my Dave Good story. it's been close to 30 years ago, believe it or not. I moved to Southern California and I landed in Garden Grove on a Thursday night, and I was staying with the guitar player, singer for the band that I was in. His name was Craig. And if you remember Dave, on Thursday nights, Jezebel's Nightclub was around.
I do. I remember. That's a long time ago, but I remember it.
So Jezebel's Nightclub was open Thursday, Friday, Saturday. He goes, hey, so there's a bunch of great bands playing. Let's go see them. I said, okay. So we went over there on Thursday night, and I was full of youth and bravado, and I thought that I knew everything in the world. And these bands got up there and started playing. And I would never, ever say anything or do anything like this now, but, you know, I just thought to myself, you know, I've got this. You know, some bands are better than others. I got this. These guys aren't so great. And again, that was a long time ago. And so the same thing happened on Friday night. We went back there and I thought the same thing. And then he goes, hey, you know what? Instead of going to Jezebel's tonight, this is Saturday night now. He goes, let's go over to the Marquee. There's a couple bands playing there. And there's a house band called Skin Tight. And they're really good. I think you'll like them. I said, okay. So again, we walk through the doors of the Marquee now, and I'm still full of that youth and bravado, thinking, okay, I'm the new drummer, and there's a new sheriff in town. Skin Tight hadn't started playing yet. And so they walk up there, and they started playing, and I'm pretty sure the first song I ever heard you play was a Bullet Boys tune, and Dave got up there, and I was just like, I gotta practice. I don't have this. Dave Good is an amazing, amazing drummer. And at the time, you were going to MI. And that's how I met Dave. And we've been friends ever since. And he's a great guy and a great drummer. And I've learned a lot from him. So there's my Dave Good story. So anyway, Dave, again, thank you for coming, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for having me. How's it going?
Good. So let's start with this. Let's start with that. Skin Tight. Okay, that was a long time ago. It was a cover band. You guys are great. You played around town. Are you still in touch with those guys? Are they still around?
Yeah, we all know each other still. It originally started off as BB4, and that was the dream of Lanny Cordola. And so he had the band together, and then it basically changed because he became a rock star and had to go on the road. And so we changed the band around, and we got the members we wanted, and we didn't know what we wanted the name to be. We had our set list. We had rehearsed. We were ready to play, but we didn't have a name. And KNAC came in, and they asked us who we were, and so we were on the spot. And so Brett, the singer, just said Skin Tight. That was all that came up. I don't know why he said that, but that was how the name came about. So it was because KNAC put us on the spot. And then it just went from there, and we went through different members, and we all stay in touch. But, you know, it's the scene is not like it was. We were lucky to have that.
Right. And you guys were kind of a Orange County regular. You were a regular band at the Marquee, and you played at all the Red Onions and stuff like that too, right?
Yeah, we had a real rotation going. That was the old days when you said yes to a gig, you were saying yes to five nights at one club. So really, you didn't have to find 20 clubs. You found four clubs, and all you had to do was show up and play.
Right. So, and then, so now I'm going to go back before that. I'm just going to ask some questions here so people do get to know you. How, you know, let's start with this. How did you get started as a drummer? What was the first thing where, you know, your first memories where you're like, that's what I want to do. I want to be a drummer.
That's an awesome question. It comes in two parts. The first part of it is when I was a kid, we would go to football games at Orange Coast College, watching the high school football games. So I saw the Costa Mesa High drum line, and we were sitting in the stands, and the band would sit down, and then the drum line would do a solo before they sat down, except that I was sitting about 2 feet away from them all. And so, you know, I, you know, it's called a cadence, but to me it was drum solo and it was just pure power. So that was it. I had already decided then. I started off on trombone and then accordion and then piano. And then right in that second, I insisted that drums were it and I wouldn't back down. And then the other part that really sealed the deal was we went to England, and we were in London, and my babysitter at the time took us out to see, we weren't supposed to go, but we went to see Black Oak, Arkansas at the Rainbow Club in London.
No way.
And that was Tommy Aldridge on drums.
Yeah.
And so halfway through the show, he does a drum solo, and then he kicks his whole drum set over, and the road crew is trying to put the cymbals back up, and he's knocking them back over, and it was just so much power. I thought that was it, and I haven't looked back since. So I would like to blame it all on Tommy Aldridge personally.
You know what's so funny about that, man, is I am a huge Tommy Aldridge fan. And I remember when I first saw you play, there was such an Aldridge vibe watching you play. You had that, I remember you had it was a gray Tama kit. Remember that? Do you still have it?
Oh, no, it was I can't say on this interview what we used to call that kit, but it was a metallic white Imperial Star.
Okay,
that's what it was. Yeah. I don't know if they make that finish anymore, but at the time it was fairly easy to find in pawn shops. I put it all together piece by piece in pawn shops, but that was before custom drum companies were around. So no, it's out there somewhere. I'm sure it'll show up, but it's not mine anymore.
Very cool. Yeah, I always remember having, you know, watching you play. Seriously, it was a real Tommy Aldridge vibe. How old were you when that all went down?
At the time when I saw him play, I think I was about 10.
Really? No kidding.
10 or 11, yeah, and that was before we came back to the States. And then it just, everything was a whirlwind from there. And then I got into drumline on high school, and the same drumline that I was originally inspired by, I became part of and started taking lessons over at West Coast with Robert Raitt while I was on the drumline. So it all pretty much just happened very fast.
How long did you study with Robert?
I think about 3 or 4 years.
Okay. And then, and what was his main point of focus with you on during the lessons?
His priority, and most good drum teachers' priority, was cleanliness of strokes. So, you know, like he understands that little kids all want to learn how to play fast, but the cleaner you are, the faster it sounds. But how do you get that point across to a 10-year-old who doesn't understand that? So he found a way of doing it. And I still have my books that he had. He used to put a circle at the top of the page, and if you got it kind of right, he would put half of an X through the circle, and you didn't get the other part of the X through the circle until you got it right. And so,
that's
so
awesome.
Yeah, when you look at all my old drum books, you see a lot of half X's and even more X's, so...
That's cool. What books did he have you working out of?
Well, my favorite one that I still like even now is The Drummer's Cookbook.
Oh, yeah. That's a great book. Fantastic book. Yeah.
So I'd like to go through there and learn how to play all that stuff left-hand lead, you know, be able to play it righty or lefty. But
I remember that back, you know, back to the skin tight thing. I that was one of the things that, you know, blew me away, and still, like, I'm so impressed by when I watch you play. You had two ride cymbals, and you had one on your right, and you had one on your left, and you would switch back and forth, and it was seamless. You know, I mean, you'd be playing right hand lead, and you'd be grooving along, and then you would just go to left hand lead, grooving along. I was like, how the hell does he do that? You know, do you still do a lot of left hand lead or play open handed a lot?
Yeah, I do all that, and to be honest with you, I think it's funny because I somehow had a premonition that Mike Mangini was going to show up someday, and I was imitating what was going to happen, except it was just a very simple imitation. But yeah, I still do that. I like playing both sides because it helps me keep my back straight. Back then, it was all about looks. Like, I like having the whole physical factor.
Yeah.
But at this point, at my age and how much I play, I like to keep my back straight, posture good, use all the limbs, use all the power of every limb, and have the ability to make melodies with all that, because who knows what I'm going to put on my kit,
right,
percussion-wise. So that's why I do is I just like to be able to do anything with everything I've got.
That's fantastic, man. That's great. So what? One of the things that inspired me to or wanted me to have you come down here, over and above the fact that we've been friends for so long, as I've been watching the videos that you're putting up on YouTube and that you're kind of filming in your rehearsal room and stuff like that. So what is it that you're doing now? When you're doing those videos, are they for education purposes, for students? Are you teaching, or what started the whole thing with the videos for you?
That's an awesome question. I started doing it just because I wanted to be able to, if I have an idea or a feeling, or if I just want to jam and have fun, really, I just wanted to have fun with it like I used to in the old days when I was a kid. You just want to set up and jam, right?
Right.
But when you're playing at church and you're playing for bands, it's not like that. You've got a job to do. So I had to be able to have fun and experiment on my own. But at the same time, I wanted to be able to promote like practicing the things that I want to get good at, and also have pieces that I could send out for, like if somebody's hiring a drummer and they want to audition, I wanted to have bits and pieces of music that I don't normally get to play at my gigs.
Right.
And so it's kind of all of it. Like, I just want to have fun, and most of all, I want to be myself and be honest about who I am. You know, if you don't like it, then just don't watch it a second time. If you do like it, then let me know so I can do more of it. But either way, what you see is me being me.
And I think that's the thing that I always appreciated about our friendship was, at the time when we met, you were going to PIT. I'll get into that in a minute. And I was, when I moved out here, I really wanted to do that, and I was just unable to do it. And so I'd always be picking your brain and stuff like that. And you would stand there and watch me and give me pointers. And it was just, you know, again, very educational and, you know, having you do that with the videos that you're doing. Back to that real quick before we move on. What are those tracks that you're playing to? Are those, because I use, like, in my lessons, I use a lot of the Tommy Igo stuff and everything like that. What are you playing to? Where is that?
That's a good question also. I call it the Academy of Andre. And that's Andre Forbes is the guy. He's the composer, keyboard player. He was basically just, I call him a genius. So, but if you type in www.freedrumlesstracks.net, but if you just type in Andre Forbes, it'll all come up, and he puts this stuff out, and he has a website where you can buy the stuff. I think he sells it for 99 cents per track at the most.
Wow.
Those are his premium tracks, and then, like he says, most of it is free, and he asks politely if you just tag his name in there. And so, I mean, if you listen to his stuff, you can't find a bad track on there. You know, obviously I like funk music, and he does gospel, he does rock, he does the fusion stuff is really crazy. So check him out.
That's awesome. There's a good plug for him. That's fantastic. Now let's talk about you know, since we're talking about the old days and stuff like that, when you were going to MI and PIT and stuff, who were the guys that you studied with, and what was the biggest thing that you took from PIT and MI and stuff like that?
That's a good question. Well, I had this, my PIT story was a lot like the story you're saying. I went and I was listening to metal and rock pretty much all the time. I thought that, you know, bringing the sticks high, hitting hard, playing fast, and anything to distort a guitar was, that was as good as it got. And then you go there, you sign up, and they have the concerts, you know, where you're basically meet the instructors, orientation concert.
Right.
And at the end of the orientation concert, I don't think I was able to speak for probably a day. Like after I heard all the instructors of that class, you know, I could go off and name them all, but I was speechless. Like to hear jazz, Latin, fusion, funk, all that stuff. And that was, you know, that was a good 25 years ago. And the music, the music scene and genres have changed probably 5,000 times since then.
Right.
You know, so then I got into it and I just did the best I could. And the advantage I had was I was in skin tight the whole time that I was there. So I would go and do classes 8 to 10 hours a day and then make the trek from Hollywood back down to Garden Grove and play 3 to 5 nights a week. So I was actually doing as well as the instructors that I was learning from. If you want to look at it from a playing point of view, I was doing what they were doing while I was a student. And I didn't realize that then. I didn't realize that I had an opportunity that nobody has.
Right.
So, you know, then it came to an end, but I did the best I could with it. And it definitely played a part in how I turned out.
Oh man, for sure. And I remember at that time when you were going there, always asking you and picking your brain about it and stuff. And you studied with Ralph Humphrey there, is that correct?
He was one of them, yeah.
Yeah, I studied with Ralph a number of years ago, but I studied with him for probably about a year. And the reason I ask about him is just on a personal note, he was to me, he was always, I consider him one of the best drum teachers I've ever had. And I've studied with some great, great, great players. But there's just something about Ralph. He just, you know, even if you, he just knew what you had to work on. He knew what your weaknesses were and how to get the most out of you. And I really appreciated my lessons with Ralph. That was, you know, he was one of the best.
My memories of Ralph are is that I would go into the room to play for him. And I would play, and sometimes he would just like tilt his head and look at me and not have anything to say. So, I mean, I'd like to meet up with him and ask him what he was thinking, because he would just look at me and not say anything. And I don't know if it was good or bad. He wouldn't laugh or I don't know what it meant. I have a feeling he was thinking that I was too set in my ways for him to be able to deal with me at that point.
Right.
You know, I'm coming in there and I want to play Metallica and I want to play Pantera, and he's trying to teach me Frank Zappa. So there's a bit of a breakdown in language there,
right.
but he was very noble about it. And I appreciate that he held back on any negative comments.
he was always, that's a good way of putting it, very noble. And, he's also very, when he would give you criticism, it was always, you know, straight up no chaser. Just, you know, this kind of sucks. Why don't you do this for a while? You get better at it.
Actually, he had a certain way of, like, he would always say, it's just the way it is.
Yeah.
It's just the way it is. That's, I remember him saying that about many situations regarding the business. And
right.
It was like, that was my takeaway from him. It's just the way it is.
Right. Right. He's a great guy, and I love Ralph. I would love to do an interview with him. So Ralph, if you hear this, maybe I'll make your phone ring, and if you would say yes, I'd greatly appreciate it.
Yeah, Ralph, I want to come to you. I want to find out what you were thinking.
Yeah. Dave and I are coming to your house, man. that's where I took lessons from, was at his house when I studied with him, but he's since moved on. For those of you who don't know who Ralph is, and he played with Frank Zappa for a long time. He's played with Barbara Streisand. He's played with, you know, just some of the greatest musicians in the world. He was the house drummer for Dancing with the Stars. Just an amazing, amazing player. And he was a founder. Him and Joe Porcaro were the founder of MI. Am I correct on that?
Yeah, that. And there was also Steve Houghton in the beginning.
Oh, yeah. Okay. All right. Well, very good. So now, do you teach? Do you give lessons, or what are you doing there?
I have in the past. At this point, I think I take it because I'm still kind of in the game. I still want to think I'm a player. But when I have time, if somebody finds me and they, if they see what I'm doing and they like my approach and they generally really like what I do, I'll take and work with them at any level, whether they're beginner or advanced, if they like what they see. Because I kind of have a strange style. I've got my own thing, and that's it. I wouldn't feel right about trying to teach people generic things when I have such a different style. I've warped it into something maybe it shouldn't be. So they have to know what they're getting themselves into. So
what do you mean by that? What do you mean you've warped it into something you think it shouldn't be?
Well, I'm in my own opinion, I'm mixing styles. And I'm mixing my opinions of styles of music where I maybe haven't actually mastered those styles. You know, it's a feel thing.
Right.
So I'm doing my version of funk, fusion, and now really I'm obsessed with gospel music now. The gospel drummers are just, that's my Musicians Institute now, is YouTube and listening to the gospel guys. But taking my impression of all that and then putting it into my language, which comes from rock. So sometimes that doesn't do it for everybody, especially songwriters. But at the same time, if you see it and you see how it projects in the music when I play around town, then you can see how it actually works in context. So that's kind of what I mean by that, if it makes sense.
No, it does. It does. It really does. Now you touched on gospel players and the fact that you we were talking about this before the podcast, that you play with a lot of church bands and a lot of worship teams around town. Talk to me about that a little bit and how that how that came to be and all that sort of stuff.
That's a good question. So without turning this into a worship service, basically, really what happened was through Skin Tight and the Rock Club days, almost everybody that I was friends with became Christian. And I would say probably about half of them have gone on to be worship leaders.
Oh, okay.
And so what happens is, you know, I get my phone rings and instead of going to a rock club like it would have been, I go to a church. It's my friends and we're playing at church instead of at a rock club. So it worked very naturally. Who I am fit right into how it just is, kind of how it worked out. It just worked out that way. And I am into it for that. I'm devoted to it for that reason. I'm going there to play for God and I'm going to do the best I can with it. And then after I'm done there, I'll go to a club and I'll bring that with me. I just won't talk about it.
Right. That's fantastic. Now, let me ask you this in regards to like playing with the church bands and stuff, because we were talking about how I've done a little bit of that too. Do you guys play with a lot of tracks?
It works differently at different ministries, different people. Every church is almost like a household.
Right.
You know, you've got different acoustics, you've got different pastors, you've got different leadership, and it's all about every church has their people that go there. So if you're playing for a place that's mostly people that are, say, 60 and above, you're going to go in and you're going to want to be able to play with brushes or percussion.
Correct.
And then if you're going to a younger place where they're doing all the current stuff, and I don't do gospel music. I'm doing, I guess you'd call it contemporary Christian.
Right, yeah.
So from a drummer point of view, that's like normal rock music, with some breakdowns. Like in the middle of it, you'll have breakdowns so there can be a prayer over the top. But other than that, it's pretty much a rock song.
Right.
Except that you're singing it to the Lord instead of people out front that are dancing. So it definitely varies, but you have to be prepared to give people what they need. And I'd say being flexible with the song arrangements and being capable with dynamics, being able to play soft or loud and play passionate, either soft or loud, that will do you good anywhere you go, but it's especially evident in church.
Yeah, I was just going to say that's something I think, you know, being able, dynamics is a big deal. Being able to, you know, just comp with the other musicians and dynamics is definitely a big deal, and especially in church. The reason I was asking about tracks is because I've been in a situation before where you're playing with tracks in a church, and I dig the count-ins because, you know, a lot of times they'll, you know, you get the title of the song at the top, you know, whatever the title of the song is, you know, glory to God. And then you a 2-bar count in and then the band's in. But where I remember one time, the first time I ever had it happen, I didn't realize that there was cues in the click. So I got my in-ears in and I'm up there playing. And then all of a sudden you hear chorus, 2, 3, 4. It's like, who said that? And it was a little, it was nice, you know, because I knew it wasn't the tune, but it was, you know, but it was definitely one of those things that the first time it happens to you, it takes you by surprise a little bit.
Yeah, I never knew that Cortana went to church, too.
That's fantastic, man. Now, you know what? I actually was not going to ask this, but as we're sitting here talking and kind of reminiscing and stuff, when you were involved with Orange County Drum and Percussion, is that correct?
I was, yeah. And they'll forever have a place in my heart.
Are they, is, what happened? Is that still around or they're no longer around or tell me the story. I'd love to hear it.
Well, obviously I'm so close to the guys. I have to keep it very generic.
That's fine.
And safe, but, they're still around somehow, some way. I'm not in touch with the key players anymore. I've reached out a little bit. I don't know who's doing what, but obviously the drums are getting built and, Travis Barker looks just as cool as he always did. So it's still happening somehow. And I'm glad because I like him and I like everybody at the company. But I kind of grew up with those guys because it was an offshoot of West Coast Drum, as
right.
you know. And so I used to shop there. And then as I grew up, I'd buy stuff. And then things went on and I started playing their drums. And then as I was going on the road, I toured with Frank Marino and I brought out one of their vented snares, and everywhere I went through every city, every drum shop wanted them. They hadn't even heard of them yet, and just by the sound of them and the look of them, I was able to sell drums for them before I was ever even employed by them. So when I came back, they were like, well, hey, we should hire you, teach you how to build drums. And then so I got into it, and at one point we had, I think, 15 or 20 guys working there in the shop, and we all used to get together and play and practice at a rehearsal studio and have drum jams after work. So really it was a total dream come true. We had the great crew and we all stay in touch with each other. And I totally, you know, I hope they're all doing good and hello to everybody, but, it kind of moved on. And as far as I know, the drums are now being built on a lower level overseas. And the custom stuff is being built here by, I don't know who's doing it now, but it seems to be just as good as it was. So I hope everybody's doing well, and that's really about all I know at this point.
Okay, yeah, and the reason I was asking is when I was talking to you about your videos, I've noticed that you have the logo and stuff, so you obviously still have a kit. Is that your main kit you play, or are you endorsed with another company, or what's going on there?
Well, with OCDP, if you worked there, if you were part of the crew at that shop, that automatically meant you were endorsed. Like, you basically wouldn't work there at the shop and,
right.
and not have drums that you were building yourself.
Exactly.
It just wasn't the kind of a no-brainer. And I just haven't, up until now, I haven't come across the company that builds custom drums that has, I just haven't been introduced to the family that I've joined yet. I am seriously impressed with DC California Drums. I'm kind of thinking that's it. I don't know if we're supposed to talk about brands and this and that, but I am very impressed with them and the people that build them. So I'll
no
say
man, it's cool. Talk about any of the companies you want. I mean, I have the companies that I endorse and that sponsor the podcast. I told you beforehand, I've got an interview coming up next week that's going to be really cool, and I'm going to be talking about the company that I play for, Gretsch Drums. But no, you can talk about, it's open forum here, man. Talk about whatever you want as far as drums are concerned. It's all you, man.
Okay, so the Gretsch army is not going to kick the door down and
you're going to go to Gretsch jail, man. Fred Gretsch will personally walk through the door and put the cuffs on you.
Well, I don't want to get maced. So.
It's not the mace, it's the taser, man. That thing hurts.
Right on.
The mace, you can muscle through that, but that taser, man, that'll stick with you for weeks.
I'll take your word for it. Yeah, so, I mean, I'm impressed with those drums, and then also Jimmy Ford, his drums.
Yeah.
And
Jimmy's an amazing player, man. Great player.
Yeah, he is. He's one of my influences, because if you love Buddy Rich, you got to love Jimmy Ford.
Completely.
And so there's that, and obviously I'm playing Soul Tone. So that, you know, between Soul Tone and DC California drums, I'm really impressed with what they've got going there.
That's fantastic, man. That's great. So I know you, the worship theme, we talked about that. Who else are you playing with? Are you touring with anybody? Are you on the road right now, or anything coming up where you're going on the road, or what's happening there?
Well, I haven't been on the road for probably about 5 years, technically by road standards, you know, where you're gone out of town, but I play around town so much, it feels like I'm on the road.
Right. Well, being a sought after drummer in Southern California still to this day is a very, very, very good thing.
Oh yeah, for sure. I've got it really good. I got no complaints.
That's one of the things that I think that I've always, I don't know, I guess it sounds kind of corny, but again, back to the way we started the podcast, I remember when I moved out here, when I moved out to California from Colorado, and I landed in town, and I just wanted to be part of it so bad. You know, I just wanted to be in the circle. I wanted to play. I wanted to be, I wanted to be somebody that was respected as a player, really, you know what I mean? And I remember seeing you out there working so much. And I do. I mean, maybe it sounds like I'm kissing his ass right now, but seriously, I did. I was always like, God, I just want to.
Won't get you anywhere. Don't bother.
I want to be like Dave. and it's nice to, you know, I guess finally be there, you know, after years and years and years of hard work. And Dave, I mean, truly, man, if you guys have not seen Dave and you get a chance, you see him at a church, or you see a band that he's playing with, go watch the guy play. Phenomenal player. So Soul Tone Cymbals. Now, I'm with Sabian Cymbals. I've been with them for a while. It was a weird story of how I got there, but I played Sabian for years and years and years, and I finally got on the endorsement roster, and I'm incredibly thankful for that. But you are with Soul Tone, so let me, let's hear that story. Talk to me about Soul Tone.
Well, that's a good one. I was scared to even try their stuff. I was literally scared because I thought that they wouldn't even sell me stuff because all they had was gospel drummers that could shred. I thought that's the way it was. I thought you were not allowed to play Soul Tone unless you were a gospel trap shredder. So I'm literally like, I think a lot of people like me feel the same way, intimidated by it. And then I went, and the new church that I play at out in Inland Empire, Chino Valley Community Church, they had a kid in there, and they had a whole Soul Tone setup, and it basically their version of A Customs. If you're a Zildjian guy,
right,
or girl. And so I played them, and I've never ever had a feeling where I played a set of cymbals and I felt like I owned them. I forgot that they were the church's. They felt like they were mine. And at the end of it, I was just, you know, it was the same thing as back in the drumline days. Every now and then you get a feeling like, I have to do this. I have to have these, whatever. I had to have them. So I went to see the Hunger Games movie, and I was filling out my endorsement application while I was watching the movie in the theater.
How did you do that?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you say multitasking, you can get yourself in trouble. I was that guy. Don't be that guy. I was that guy. So I filled out my application in the theater while I was watching the movie, and I thought, no, they're not going to call me back, but I like the cymbals so much. Maybe I can get a phone number and find out where to buy them. And then 2 days later, they sent me a return email welcoming me to the family.
Way to go, man.
And then I got to know them a little bit, and they're super nice people. And what it is that I want in a company, they have, where they talk to people and they bring you in. They want to hear what you have to say. They, you know, you have to be willing to go and play in videos so that they can promote your career. So what a drag, right?
Right.
So, but basically they're all very nice people. They're as nice as the cymbals are nice sounding. And then the same church bought one of their drum sets, and you've seen this drum set in a lot of the photos, and I played it and I almost had to stop playing because it sounded so good. It was that distracting. So between the cymbals, the drums, and how nice they are, I just decided that I was willing to dive in head first in with them, just because they've got something happening and I want to be part of it.
That's fantastic, man. That's very, very, very cool. And then we got to give a plug here too. We'll talk about this to our friends at Aquarian. You're an Aquarian guy too.
Yeah, Roy Burns rules.
Roy Burns does rule. Roy Burns is, you know, Chris and I talked about this in our podcast. I don't know if you listened to it or not, but I think the thing that I love about Roy so much is that he's done it all in the business. He's played with the biggest artists of his time. He's been an educator. He was the first clinician. He's written books. He's a manufacturer. He's done it all. And on top of it, he's just a sweetheart of a guy.
Yeah, he's got all that. And then to be honest with you, anybody who's got real life Buddy Rich stories, you know you want to hang close to them, right?
That's no doubt, man. You know what? One day I went over right there. See, we're sitting in my studio, and I have a thing on the door. It's some rudiment things that I teach, and on the bottom of it, there's a Buddy Rich paradiddle lick, and Roy taught that to me, and he wrote it out for me, and I'd made the comment something about, I only've got this one Buddy Rich lick now, and he looks at me, he goes, you only need one. I just cracked up. I love that, man. So that's my one Buddy Rich lick. It's over there on that sheet.
Yeah, he's got the old school humor. That's great. They don't build them like that anymore.
They don't. And you know what? When you go to Aquarian, that's when it's turned into an Aquarian plug. But that's one of the things I said to Chris. You were talking about the company, the Soul Tone company. You like playing for them, and the people are great. And that's the thing that about Aquarian. I've been with the company again for a really long time. And whenever I go over there, I can't just run in and, hey, I need to grab some heads and a couple of pads, and get the heck out of here. You got to have time because you're part of the family. You go over there and you hang out, and it's fun. And I think that's, to me, that's being involved with a company, and working with a company. That's incredibly important because they're going to work with you. They're going to listen to your ideas. And I love that about Aquarian. And that's what I try to do with all of my companies. Aquarian is incredibly, incredibly receptive to that stuff.
Yeah, they always have been. They listen, they make good product, and they're obviously trying to be, they're being competitive in an ultimately mortally competitive drum world. So, and they, to be able to have the owner of the company help carry your stuff out, and he's played for who he's played for, he's behind you because he knows that you're into it. You know, that's all there is.
Oh, completely, man. Completely. And again, just great company. So, enough about Aquarian. Chris is going to hear that and call me up. Put me in Aquarian jail.
Chris Brady has really good flams, everybody. Check him out. He's a flam master. So I'm gonna pump that.
Chris Brady's flams?
Yeah, he's got cool flam licks. He'll deny it, but he's got them. So.
Dude, Chris has got some chops, man. Chris is a great player.
Well, he's a Jeff Beccaro fan, so automatically I like him.
Dude, have you seen that? He has a picture that Greg Bissonette gave him. There's a picture of Greg Bissonette and Jeff Beccaro, and I think Jeff is holding a baby, and Greg, it was his son, when he was just newborn. Anyway, it's in his living room right by the front door, and he's a huge Beccaro fan and a huge Bissonette fan, and what more can you ask for?
That's good stuff.
Yeah, it really is. So let's go here and then we'll maybe wrap it up. What now? You obviously you talked about your way into the gospel stuff and funk and R&B and stuff. At the end of the day, what to you is the most important thing about being a drummer, and what is your job? Because you said you had a different style, and you've morphed some stuff together. What's your job? What is it that you feel is your job and your role within a band or within a musical situation?
Well, in my own opinion, if I'm going to put it in my words, making sure that the musicians that you're playing for feel supported. You're basically, if you want to look at it, I look at it, I'm creating the ground that they're walking on, so that the singers, or the soloists, or anybody who's out front can step out and sound good to the audience. So it's basically a support role. So when you get your chance, you can play and you can interpret. But when I'm playing, like, where people are dancing or worshiping, my goal is to make the band sound good and also connect with the audience. If I have a chance to be able to personally connect with the audience and they have fun and they're watching me, I'll have fun with it. But it all has to be, it's all based on making the band sound good. And I'm part of a team, and the drums play a certain role, and that's to support the band. So that's what I give everything I can to do.
I love that. The thing that I've often said is that being a drummer in the band, it's the drums are the ultimate support instrument. You know, I'm there. I agree with you, and I'm just trying to elaborate on how I feel about it too, because I think that your job as a drummer is to hold the band together, listen to what having big ears and listening and maybe understanding what the other players need, and keeping them together, you know, just keeping the whole vibe together.
Yeah, for sure. It's that. And I would say the invisible part of it that's hard to talk about is that when you get that going and you're holding it all together and everything's the way it should be, then as you make little changes and you send out little signals to the bass player, the keyboard player underneath what's going on, then that can create those magic moments. And those magic moments are what set drummers apart. So it's not really the licks you're playing. It's how the band is responding to what you're doing.
100%. It's almost become, for me, it's almost become a cliche in drumming, you know, that, you know, the three most important things are groove, time, and feel. But I think to create those things, to create the groove, the time, the feel, to create the pocket, you have to, again, for me, and this is just me, you know, I ask you the question, I'm just elaborating on my standpoint. You do have to have big ears and listen to what the people need so that you can create those moments. What are some of the things, and maybe this is a question that you can't answer because I don't know that I could, what do you listen for? What do you do so that you can send those things out to the rhythm section so that you can make those things happen?
Well, that's part of my whole vibe that's different is I come in and I've already I'm trying to size the band up from the moment I roll up. Like when I park in the parking lot and they pull up, the way that they say hello to me tells me how their day is going. And then as we're setting up, I'm listening to what they're talking about and I'm watching how they're setting their gear up and I'm seeing what they emotionally need beyond all the music. Because we're people and we're living life together, right? And especially when you're in a band together with certain members and you're not always doing sub work. So I'm already looking for where they're at emotionally. And then basically once we start playing, like, what's going to be fun? How can you make somebody laugh? You want to make somebody laugh. You want to make somebody bring their energy level up. And whatever I can do to instigate having fun is what I'll do. So it's more of an emotional issue. And then the music works with that after the fact.
That's great, man. I love that. That's really cool. That's fantastic. That's great. Let's do this. What's you have a website, you have a YouTube channel, you have a Facebook, do you send up smoke signals? How can we find Dave Good?
If you just type in Dave Good, you'll find me all. I've got a YouTube channel. I've got a Facebook. I've got an Instagram. I'm working on updating my Reverb Nation. I've never really done a website yet because, you know, I've felt that since I'm mostly in the cover scene, I haven't really achieved anything of my own solo wise. So I don't really pump myself too much just because I consider myself a hard working musician. But all the bands that I play for, they have their dates up, you know, but I have that stuff. If you just type in my name, you'll find me. I'm everywhere.
And, you know, I actually asked her this. We were talking about the worship teams, and I told you that I play for a worship team from time to time over at Eastside. And the bass player, she's married to the worship leader. Their last name is Juke Nellis, but her maiden name is Good. And I was like, hey, are you related to Dave Good? It's like, no, never heard of the guy. Just kidding. But no, I thought maybe it was your sister or something at first.
You know, who knows what history has, but nah, I've got a younger brother and that's it.
That's cool, man. That's awesome. All right. So, and then, you know what? You said something, and this is how I'm going to end the podcast. Because you said something to me that was very near and dear, and that really hits home with me. When you first got here, we got into the bus, into the Monster, and
cool bus. I'm lucky. I'm lucky to be able to have seen it.
Oh, dude! I'm glad you were here to look at it, and you saw the picture of my dad. And what did you ask me?
Verbatim.
Yeah. Go ahead and go for it.
I asked you if he was an ass kicker.
And I said, yes, he was. My dad, my father, Boyd Robley, was an ass kicker. His one thing was that he plugged into my head and beat into my head was work ethic. My dad was extremely, extremely successful and in every sense of the word. And he would say to me, you know, success is easy. Be the first one there and the last one to leave, and work harder than everybody else. And you just were talking a little bit right there at the end, and you were talking about, you know, you said work hard. So what are your thoughts on work ethic? And maybe that's kind of a way generic question, but, you know, maybe not. Give me your thoughts on it.
There's nothing generic about that, because it means whatever it means to anyone. And I would say that I have a strong work ethic, but I wouldn't say it's anything I learned off of paper. I learned it from the examples of everyone around me, starting with my parents and their parents. Like, what I saw from the beginning was anything worth doing is worth working hard. And if you want something that's worth having, you're going to have to give everything you have to it. So really, for me, I do that with everything. And the only difference is that I try to get rid of the things that aren't worth diving in headfirst over. So I try as hard as I can at everything I do, and I just need to make sure that I'm doing the right things, because I've made plenty of mistakes over the years. That would be a whole nother topic.
I alone could do 20 podcasts on that. I always joke around and say, don't open my closet because you will be trampled to death by skeletons. But I think we all have those. But I think that's great, man. I mean, just and I, you know, again, you know, back to the top of the podcast, that was, you know, when you were going to MI, the work ethic that it took to do that was amazing. And obviously I didn't live it like you did, but I watched it, and I did. I'd come in, dude. I was there all the time watching you play, and there was a few nights I was intimidated, like, you can't believe there was a wall of marshals, and Dave would stand right behind the marshals, and he would watch me play, and I'd be like, oh my gosh, and then he'd give me tips at the end of the night. It was great, beginning of a fantastic friendship.
Well, I'll say that I've watched you all along, and I'm just as impressed with you. You've put in 100%, and I'm looking around the room right now, and I see nothing but drums. You've turned into quite the drummer yourself, and I got to watch you put in the work, so good job, dude.
Well, thanks. Likewise, man. We'll leave it at that. So, everybody, listen, thank you so much for listening, and Dave, thank you from the bottom of my heart for coming over.
Thanks for having me. Thanks, everybody.
And so check out Dave Good. Spell your name for everybody, Dave.
G-O-O-D-E.
See, he's got the E on the end. That's what makes him extra cool. He actually holds his pinky up when he says it, too. Everybody, thanks. Thanks so much for listening. Next week, I got a fantastic interview coming up with one of the people from Gretsch Drums, and you want to check that out. Check out my past podcasts on YouTube, The Bart Factor. Go to drummerswag.com and check out Aquarian Drumheads. Thank you guys so much. I'll see you in the next episode. See you, Dave.
Peace out.